Yes, hi, welcome. Thank you, Glenn, for that. I also want to acknowledge the Noongar people of this country who I've had the pleasure of visiting for the last couple of months, as Glenn mentioned. And I'd like to acknowledge the other Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people in the audience and the other artists from the AAA Indigenous Art Awards who are here today. So, welcome, thank you. Please move forward, I'm not going to bite trigger on. It's just too much of an expanse in front of me. But feel free to move forward if you need to. What I will be talking about for my half hour talk will be on the four artists that I wrote for in the catalogue. I had the wonderful pleasure of writing on Tiger for Culture. We'll move in the next, when I get to it, but Niliari Around the Corner, Paul Paul, and Lena. So Lena's here today, so I hope I do her justice with my explanations of her paintings and that. Firstly, as Greg mentioned, I'm the curator of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Art at the National Gallery, and over the six, 7-odd years that I've been working there, I've had the pleasure of meeting so many artists, and even more so, more artists whilst being a panellist for the WA Art Award. And I've had the pleasure of, well, I've met Lena and Tiger, and I would really love to, I look forward to the day when I do meet the other artists. Tiger Kapalcha, he's a Pitjantjatjara man who, when I first started working at the National Gallery of Australia, I didn't immediately connect with the one work that we have acquired of his. I'm a Virgo, I like law and order, law and orderly. And so when I came across Tiger's work, I thought, whoa, what is going on here? But over the years, as I've experienced his works more and more, I just absolutely love them. As with the other three works, they're really quite, his work's really quite abstract, and I love his use of bright colours of late. Some of his early works that I've seen have certainly been much more muted colours, and I absolutely love the selection that Glenn's made for this art award. And the story behind his works relate to two brothers and their wives, the two wives, and the women would go out every day and collect the food and bring it back, and they got quite cranky. The men, who, as far as they could see, were only sitting around doing nothing and performing ceremonies. So one day they got quite annoyed at that and ate all the food. So of course the men were really quite wild at them for that, and wanted to punish the women, so they turned themselves into large snakes. So you can see in each of the works, the snake figure there, I think it's the Wati. And the women, of course, were out collecting. They saw this wonderfully big, fat snake. They were chasing it, trying to collect it. So they were digging away at trying to capture this particular, or the two brothers who turned into snakes, and the brothers were being really cheeky and just getting out of their grasp and, just sort of keep leading them on. And as the women were digging and digging and digging over days, this is again a story about formations in the country and how landscapes were formed. So as the women were digging after this big fat snake, they formed a large canyon or so in Tiger's country. And eventually they thought, well, we'll be clever, we'll dig in front of the snake and capture it that way. And of course, when they saw the snake as it came out, it gave them quite a bit of a fright, and there was a bit of a battle that ensued, and the women threw their digging stick at one of the brothers, who now, according to Tiger, is a tree with a limb sticking out of it in that particular area in country. And the other brother the brothers then ate the women. And so there's another tree, as he talks in his story, that's in country that is really quite lumpy, and that describes how the brothers had eaten the women. So with Tiger stories, as with many of these works that are in the exhibition, knowing the stories behind the works, which can be quite elusive to many people, for those that are not from those communities, just enriches them more and more. And what I love about Tiger's works, as I said, not only with the use of colour, but once you've got the knowledge of the story, it just makes it so much more richer. And I think, Glenn, you said that Tiger's now incorporating more and more of the cross in his work?
Yes, it's the little cross that you see on this work over here, the one with Jaffa, that's his signature. So I was talking with the Art Centre coordinator yesterday, and he often will do the signature at the end and he'll say Tiger.
Oh, okay,
so it's
right.
The finish of his paintings.
Which is a wonderful touch. So, again, he's an artist who's self-taught and didn't start painting until later on in life. And as with, a number of the artists, the three of the artists that I'll be talking about, that they actually didn't start their artistic career until... commercial artistic career until later on in life, because they've all each and every one of the artists has a wealth of knowledge from a lifetime of knowledge and experience, and it's not until later on in life that they may have picked up the paintbrush and put their stories to canvas or to whatever medium that they actually use today. The next artist that I'm talking about is actually around the corner, and I don't know, should we move around there if we're going along that way, or it's a small area? As we move along, we'll stop for a moment and you can have a look at Niliari's works around the corner here. Niliari is one of the artists that started earlier on in his career in his 30s, and he was influenced heavily by his father, Pinter Pinter, who, it's a bit hard to describe, but Niliari paints with pretty much two or three colours. So it's white, always white on a red or black background, and he scratches the surfaces of his painting. Perhaps we can walk around, because it's a bit hard. I mean, it'd be wonderful for you to see the words, which are so textual. And again, as you can see with a number of the artists in the exhibition, he scratches the paint, the surface of the paint, to reveal a layer below, as though there's several, not necessarily hidden, but layers to each of the paintings. And I just love the wonderful texture that you get on the works. So as you can see, that his concentric diamond shapes are the rock holes, and it's the pathways between them in his country. And I love the way that he draws you in and pulls out different aspects or different rock holes that makes them larger and some of the others that are smaller. And the sort of pulling and pushing of each of the works, particularly, say this third one, the smaller one, which is really quite a beautiful, subtle work. He's becoming more and more recognised within his particular community. So he's still, a relatively young artist, and quite recognisably his design and his style of painting. So that's what I love about a lot of the artists in this exhibition. Once you know the artist's style and the types of stories that they tell, you become quite knowledgeable about the different artists. So Niliari, I'm really quite happy that I had the opportunity to write on him. So now, along with Paula Paul, along with five other women from the Mornington Island community, started artist collective. And only recently, say the last, say 7-8 odd years, Another one of the well-known artists from that collective is Sally Gabori, who is known for her large, large-scale, colourful paintings. But Paula Paul is one of the artists who, unlike many of the others here who often paint about aspects of country or stories of history or of, you know, ancestral stories, Paula paints about a particular practice that the women do in that community where they go out and collect cockles, the shellfish, and the paintings depict those, the way that the women line the cockles up in orderly rows in the fireplace. So you can see in each of the paintings the rows and lines of these little bivalves or, you know, shellfish that they collect and cook. And it's, from what I understand, it's for no particular reason, no cultural type reasons. It's just what the women like to do. They like the sort of law and order of laying it out, and that's just how they you know, cook that particular food. And what I love about Paula's work is, I mean, again, it's the bright fluorescent colours, and it's almost as though, you know, she's capturing the, you know, the ocean colours beneath, and you know, she just, her use of the pinks and the yellows on often with her works, a matte background, whether it's the blues, the purples or a black, you know, it really just brings out the colours in the work. So, you know, that's what I loved about Paula's work is that, you know, it wasn't, and with many other, you know, artists around the world, it's not often, you know, just about culture or, you know, ancestral stories and how landscape was formed. You know, hers is just about the sort of general practice that the women used to, you know, do in that community. So, you know, as the ladies were moved off Bentinck Island after, you know, their food source was sort of contaminated from a large sort of, I don't know if it was a tsunami as such, but a large flooding of salt water onto their lands, you know, they then moved to Mornington Island, and this is where, you know, they've been able to maintain their practices, even though they can't necessarily or always gather food sources from their, you know, traditional islands. So that's Paula Paul. Lena here, we have, I hope I do you justice, Lena. Lena Niaki, whose works are here on this wall here. I absolutely adore Lena's works for a number of reasons, but as I've mentioned before, and I'll come into that soon, but as I've mentioned before, Lena was in her 60s before she started or, you know, commenced painting on canvases as such. And from what I understand, the story is with these particular works is that ancestral women laid nets across waterways to catch barramundi, and these are the sites. This site is with near Argyle Diamond Mine, is that right? Yeah. And that the Gidja people who Lena's from believe that the diamonds from the mine are the scales of the barramundi. And what I love about Lena's works is that if you get the chance to have a look up close, it's the real textural quality. And from what I understand is that, you know, she was taught or shown how to prepare the canvases by another well-known Gidja artist, Paddy Jamaji. And when you get up close and you see just the, you know, the contrast of the materials that are used on the paintings, it's just divine. So you've got the lines which represent the nets and, of course, the other half circles are the scales of barramundi, is that right? Yes? Yeah. So, again, with Lena's works, it's you know, the typical colours of the Kimberley area and the use of the country in, from, the materials from the country, from her country there. So, you know, with the commencement of the diamond mine, Argyle Diamond Mine, you know, a lot of Gidja people believe that, you know, I mean, a lot of sacred sites have been destroyed because of the mining in that area. So, which is a you know as beautiful as these works are, it's got a real for me a sad story behind it when you know that particular sites are being destroyed. But it's wonderful to know how you know the Gidja people believe the diamonds came about, which is a wonderful way of thinking about those that material.